Fasten your seatbelts. It's going to be a bumpy night.
We don't need no badges. I don't have to show you any stinking badges.
I tell you right out, I'm a man who likes talking to a man who likes to talk.
You're gonna have to answer to the Coca-Cola Company.
Hey, Luke.
May the Force be with you.
You are a toy!
You're quite
uglier than I am. That didn't
come out right.
Harry, what is it?
The stuff that dreams are made of.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of The Stuff That Dreams Are Made Of, the section of the Fanatarium, the newly minted Fanatarium. We've been the Fanatarium for a fair bit. But yeah, we're the corner of the Fanatarium dedicated to classic films, namely by going over the AFI Top 100 Films. I, as always, am Stephen Sparky Parker, and I'm joined by...
Jessica Parker.
Hi, Jessica Parker.
Hi, Stephen Parker. Long time no see.
Yeah. Long time no podcast. We just do this once a month.
Yes, once a month.
Well, yeah.
We try, guys.
I try to stagger it with the Stephen and Stephen show, but Steve C. is such a... well-liked person that his schedule is quite hectic and sometimes harder to get together. And you're just, like, right here, so...
But you never have to worry about little old me.
Mm-hmm. Well, I worry about you constantly. But... Anyways, this is really boring banter for what is going to be a really packed episode.
It's packed!
It's packed! So, obviously, we're going to talk about some classic films. We've got the F.W. Murnau silent classic. It's our first silent film, too.
I love silent films!
Sunrise. And we've also got the Stanley Kubrick. I almost said Steven Spielberg. The Kubrick, Kirk Douglas, Gladiator classic Spartacus. Which will also be fun to talk about.
I'm Spartacus!
No, I'm Spartacus!
No, I'm Spartacus!
Oh, okay. But first things first, back from my days on the my original podcast, the 2 Cents Movie Podcast, we would always wait until halfway through the year to compile our top 10 of the year lists, just to give us a chance to see all the movies, we just to make sure we didn't leave anybody out.
All those fools do it in January? Just kidding, they're cool.
No, they just probably have more access to films than we do. And I've got a fair amount. And most of them I am seeing right as they come out. But, you know, there are a few that I did not quite catch until this year. So I'm glad that I waited to compile it. So,
yeah, well, we're pretty excited. We are both ready with our lists, and I think Steven here is going to start us off.
Okay.
Bring us in.
And if you're only here for the lists, I know some lists are fantastic and people love listening to the lists, so, but we have something else that I stole from another podcast that I also did on the 2 Cents Movie Podcast for the end of the show, which will be of import over the next coming months, a summer box office challenge. So stick around after the reviews for that. But first things first, let's do our lists.
It's pretty exciting though, guys. It's like March Madness, but better. And I'll fight you on that. so first, Steven's list.
Okay. We're going to start from the tens and work our way down like we do with the AFI list. We start with the garbage and
work. Those 100.
Yeah. We start with the trash, and then we work our way up to the good stuff, so...
Back to the triple and double digits.
Mm-hmm. So, my number 10 film of the year, I had some debate. We'll discuss some honorable mentions and stuff afterwards, but... ultimately, I went with movies that had the greatest impact on me, both in entertainment value or in things that made me think. And my number 10 spot actually goes to Darren Aronofsky's Mother. Now, Jessica, you didn't get a chance to see this one.
And I'm still jealous.
Forget what you were doing that night. I think you had, like, visits or you were visiting a friend or something like that.
Something like that.
But yeah, and I just hobbled my way to the theater to check out Darren Aronofsky's movie. And some of his movies are hit and miss. Like, I didn't really care for Noah or Black Swan, but I really liked Requiem for a Dream. And I think this kind of fits in that scenario. It's deeply allegorical, you know, it's kind of crazy, you know, that this, there have been a lot of think pieces on it, you know, Darren Aronofsky's said a lot about it. You can read different things into it, like it's an analogy for Mother Earth and religion, or the trials of dating a creative. But I think, you know, for all the things that it envelops, you know, it has a rather unique style and a really crazy ending as well. So my number 10 is Mother. Mother!
Mother!
There's an exclamation
Mama.
Point.
Mama! Oh, yeah.
Mama! Mama! Sorry, Snatched did not make our list.
Nope. So for my list, I kind of like to put movies on there that I feel like Steven, really impacted me, but also don't really get a lot of the visibility they deserve, is kind of part of what I think about. It's like, oh, what movies haven't my friends and family heard of that they really should have? And so for my number 10, I picked Colossal.
Mm-hmm.
We saw it super early last year, but I just... loved it. It's a ladies movie, you know, it's a movie about I don't know, discovering yourself, separating yourself from the burdens of a relationship, or it's just straight up fascinating, guys. It's fun, it's funny, it's surprising.
Mm-hmm.
And Anne Hathaway, as always, is kick-ass. You always underestimate her, at least I do, and then I go and I'm like, oh yeah, Anne Hathaway, I mean, stinking Anne Hathaway. I mean, dear old Anne Hathaway.
Oh, Jessica.
It's not like your family listens to our podcast.
It's not like I go through and have to bleep you every time you drop an F-bomb.
This whole thing will be cleaned out. You'll never know it's here.
Okay.
All right, Steven, you're number 9.
Oh, I'll leave enough to keep it interesting. So, but yeah, we may hear more on Colossal later on in our countdown. Wonder what's up with that. My number 9 film is another one that Jessica didn't see. I think she was on another girls' night and I was feeling sick, so this is one I actually caught up with on Amazon Prime, and it is A Ghost Story. And I figured Jessica might not be into this because you're not a big Casey Affleck fan.
Boo! Sorry.
But, you know, I think you might find him more enjoyable when he's covered in a big white sheet for most of the movie.
Who could it be? Certainly not Casey Affleck.
And something, I think that it is actually him that is under the sheet for most of that, which I find completely unnecessary and makes entire sense for Casey Affleck and the director. But anyways, you know, it's an unconventional ghost story. It's a rather short film too. You know, I think it's like even under 90 minutes.
Oh.
You know, it tells the story of a man who dies and like it becomes a stereotypical ghost under a sheet living in his house. And, you know, he's haunting his ex-wife or girlfriend or Rooney Mara, his ex-Rooney Mara, and seeing her things. But then she leaves, and then he sticks around, and it kind of follows him around, and It's one of those films that doesn't need a lot of dialogue to say what it's doing, but is so visually great, and the music is fantastic too. And it really stuck with me. So yeah, A Ghost Story is one. It's on Amazon Prime, so if you guys haven't seen it and you're interested in those kind of visually visually stimulating films, check this one out.
Okay. My number 9 is Detroit, and that is because this movie shook me and basically it just stayed with me. It kind of relates back to my number 1. I think the advertisements implied, it's a story in American history that most Black people have heard of. You know, African Americans know this kind of stuff goes down, but a lot of maybe the rest of the population is kind of blissfully ignorant. And I just think it's a good thing to learn about, you know, your fellow Americans and think about our history and where we've come and where we need to go. And just so pertinent with the kind of upswing in racial tensions in our country, and just a good empathy machine.
Yeah.
But also just shakes you up.
Shakes you up. Yeah, we may hear more about that one later on too. So my number 8 film is more of a fun film, and that would be Steven Soderbergh's Logan Lucky. Last year there was a film called Logan, and there was a film called Lucky, but I went with Logan Lucky. And they call it inside the film Ocean 7-Eleven, basically. And it's kind of like these, and it is another film that I think kind of speaks politically to our time, you know, with the, you know, undervalued people, you know, staging a heist to get a piece of the pie that they're owed by society. And, but, you know, it is a fun ride. You know, you got Channing Tatum and Adam Driver as these brothers. Adam Driver especially is great. But, of course, I think the best part of this movie is Daniel Craig, who's a revelation, you know. And a lot of his films, he does not seem to be having very much fun. He's very stoic or, you know, drab or anything like this. But in this one, he's jobbing, and he's on fire, and he's having the time of his life. And he is fantastic. So I think this one is also on Amazon Prime. So check it out. Logan Lucky, my number 8.
All right. And my number 8, also on Steven's list, I believe, but I get to talk about it first. It's The Florida Project. This movie just really impacted both of us. It's one we kind of kept going back to and talking about. It's a story. We kind of compared it to The Little Rascals in a sense, because the main focus of the film is these kids that are growing up in Orlando, Florida, on the outskirts of Disneyland or Disney World.
Disney World.
Literally, like, on these hotels right around Disney World. Their parents are kind of living paycheck to paycheck, so they live in this hotel. And just kind of these kind of rascally street urchin hustling kids. And, you know, Willem Dafoe puts in the performance of a lifetime. Mm-hmm. It's just... not performance of a lifetime, but just kind of like maybe evens out his acting chops with such a sympathetic, you know, he's usually kind of a strange or otherly kind of character to me. He's not usually like an everyman. And in this, he kind of gets to play, maybe I just haven't seen enough of his filmography, but I loved him. And just the story of these people and how they live makes you think, makes you laugh, makes you cry. It's just one of a kind.
Yeah, like Jessica said, we may be talking about that later on here. All right, my number 7 film is, I think technically it may have came out in 2016 in, like, limited markets to qualify for, like, an Oscar run, but it got its proper release here in the States in 2017, so I went with Your Name, which is one of the movies. It was from earlier in the year, like around March, I think. I saw it in the theater on my day off. So, Jessica, you didn't get a chance to see it in the theater. Mm-mm. but we rented it on home video, and it, you know, the premise, you know, at first seemed kind of weird to me. Like, it's about these teens who keep finding themselves switching bodies, and, you know, they're doing some sort of Americanized remake, and, you know, it does address some of the elephants in the room in a surprisingly, I would even say, tasteful way. You know, I think it acknowledges what would happen in some cases, but doesn't go overboard on it.
If a boy and a girl were to
swap bodies in the midst of puberty and stuff like that. But it does have interesting twists and turns, and I think, you know, this is one of those anime that kind of digs deeper. You know, I used to, you know, have a stigma with anime that it's, you know, it's all just like boobs and, you know, monsters and stuff like that. But, you know, there's some really good stuff, even though Studio Ghibli is no more. So,
alas.
Well, they may be making a comeback. I don't know. But, yeah. So yeah, Your Name is on there. What did you think of Your Name?
Same. It was just really cute and daring, quality animation. Worth seeing. Yeah. I'm curious what the American remake is going to be like. I can't quite imagine it pulling it off as well.
Mm-hmm.
So my number 7 was The Shape of Water. And okay, this got an Oscar. However, I just love, you know, Del Toro. He's an amazing director. He does an amazing job creating an atmosphere in this movie. You just can get lost in it. It's tangible. It's beautiful. It takes you back to, you know, it's kind of a real, it's a period piece in a way, as much as it's a fantasy, and just takes you back to this slice of Americana. You know, you've got the, and it's funny because it's like, you know, your kind of action espionage movie, except the focus is on like the people that never get, you know, the spotlight. It's the cleaning ladies. And, you know, the people, they just, even during kind of the more espionage-y parts of this movie, they can get away with some stuff because nobody's expecting the cleaning ladies to be behind things, you know? And it's about love, and it's about, you know, it's about gender. I mean, but, you know, it's about feminism, the kind of the toxic masculinity of the era, and kind of the more tender parts that exist underneath. And, oh, she's fantastic. Everybody does just a great job. Michael Shannon is the most hateable villain, and he's the first name I say, and it's a woman's movie. Mm-hmm. Good grief, shame on me. What's
Sally Hawkins?
Sally Hawkins is amazing without saying a word. You know,
Richard Jenkins,
Octavia Spencer. I was getting the O, but I couldn't.
And you call yourself a feminist.
I'm working on it, guys, ladies, gentlemen, and ladies.
And you call yourself. I'm just kidding.
But it was just a great movie. And even though it got an Oscar, I think it's still very underrated.
Yeah.
As far as viewing.
Yeah, that was really in close contention to make my list. It's a definite honorable mention, but it did hurt to leave that one off. So, my regrets to The Shape of Water, but I'm glad I found a place on your list. So, my number 6 is actually one that was released direct to streaming, and that would be the Netflix film Okja.
Uh-huh.
a few years ago, Bong Joon-ho made Snowpiercer, which is a fantastically weird film. And this film is different, but it does have the same kind of bizarre tone associated with it, where it goes for like really broad comedy and also some fairly disturbing images, but also a really sweet story all mixed together. It has a fantastic Jake Gyllenhaal performance. It's Jake Gyllenhaal that I knew, and it's like, oh man, people are just gonna love or hate this, but I think it is genius what he's doing. It's kind of like the big role you wouldn't imagine him doing. And then like even some of the other smaller role, or like Paul Dano is not insufferable in it. And we got like Steve Yeun, we got Tilda Swinton
not to be forgotten,
playing twins again.
There's too much Tilda to be contained as one character.
So, you know, the Okja is delightful, but we watched this movie while eating pork chops. So
it was just very ironic, guys. That's ironic, right?
Yeah. I don't know. Ask Avril Lavigne. So, but yeah, my number six film is Okja, now streaming on Netflix.
All right. As for my number six, that is a solid Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri. Frances McDormand just killed it. She is the saltiest lady. She's kind of that angry woman that we all have inside us that we don't get to let out. And she's just amazing, you know, not for nothing. She kind of lives this rough life. Her daughter passed away, but their family wasn't perfect, and it just kind of makes it even more bitter. She puts up a billboard accusing the police of having squandered their time on the investigation. She's murdered, she's raped, and burned to death, and it's horrific, and she says that the police department has done nothing. She specifically names the chief of the police department and slanders him, and oh, guys, it just goes on from there. It's amazing. It's got Woody Harrelson. It's got Sam Raimi. It's got... Sam Rockwell. Excuse me, not the cursed director that I... Well, you know, Steven says I shouldn't dislike him so much. But it's got Sam Rockwell. It's got my favorite from Game of Thrones.
Dinklage.
It's just a powerhouse cast, guys. And for some reason, a random Australian lady, who's also pretty cool.
That's Abby Cornish.
Oh, and her friend that works at the shop is awesome. It's just a great movie, guys. Fun characters, a good... It's just a look at small-town America and kind of working in the legal field and seeing this lady kind of rage against the machine. I absolutely love it. Stuff the police, you know? and just like the way that it tackles racism in the department, and you know, they get a new chief and he's a black chief and he kind of goes in there and kind of tears up the little old boys club, at least the racist old boys club. And I don't know, just so many things about this movie that I love, and it deserved every award it got, and Frances McDormand is amazing.
Yep.
So three billboards outside Ebbing, Missouri, see it.
Another one that has won multiple Oscars, so.
There's Oscars...
nothing wrong with it, Jessica.
The fact that movies get the Oscars these days doesn't mean they're necessarily getting the wide recognition they deserve, as far as people will watch the Oscars and be like, well, movie's dead, you know?
So. Anyways, my number five film, we're into the good stuff, Jessica.
The good stuff.
This is the one film that brought me perhaps the most joy this past year. I think it's one of the most rewatchable films of the year. And that is the Lego Batman movie.
It's pretty golden.
Yeah. And that's ultimately all I have to say to that. Basically, my favorite line is when Michael Cera is Robin and is saying, well, my name is Richard Grayson, but the other kids call me Dick. And Batman's like, children can be cruel.
The whole movie is so quotable. It's great, guys.
So yeah, Lego Batman movie is fantastic, so good job.
And I like having lighter things on the list. Way to go. I put Molly's Game on my list. It's just kind of an awesome kind of feminist film. I don't know, it's just an interesting look, kind of an intimate look at a woman's life that's not your typical, stereotypical... I don't know. She's
lady.
She's just this amazing woman. She was an Olympian. She becomes like a crime boss in a way. Not quite, but.
Yeah, she runs underground poker games.
For crime bosses. Just kidding. Famous folks, eventually Russians. Anyway. It's just great. And this movie just hit home for me. It's beautiful. It's about family relationships. It's about, you know, sticking to your morals. It's Idris, it's got, what's her face that plays the...
Jessica Chastain.
One of those redheads. I always want to call her Bryce Dallas Howard. But it's got Jessica Chastain. It's got Idris Elba. It's an amazing film. And I just loved it, and I recommend it. So
both of our number five films had Michael Cera.
Yeah, except in mine, he was a total douche.
Be careful, I have a limited Spoilers. Amount of beeps, Jessica. So watch your potty mouth. My number four film, Jessica already mentioned it, it is Detroit. So yeah, this film very much shook me to the very core of my thing. This helped contribute to my wokeness, I guess. Like Jessica was saying, you know, I'm sure many African-American peoples are well aware of this type of story and having to live with it, but it was very compellingly made by Kathryn Bigelow. I feel like not many people got this movie. Like, a lot of, or maybe I'm just not as sophisticated, but a lot of critics were not into this movie, but the center point with the events at that hotel in Detroit were shaking, and I even liked the stuff that led up to and was after it. Mm-hmm. Will Poulter is just one of those guys with a face that you want to punch in the face.
And he just has
that face, and he's
in front of him.
Yeah, and then, you know, I've totally forgot the lead kid's name, but he's got a good career ahead of him as well. So, you know, this movie is hard to watch.
Oh, yeah.
But it is playing on Hulu, and I think you should watch it, so.
And, you know, I think we did really sing its praises a few episodes back,
mm-hmm.
as we spoke about The French Connection.
Possibly, yeah.
You've heard us go on about this one before, and you just should see it.
So yeah, my number four film, Detroit. I liked it more than Jessica.
It's a contest now, guys. My number four film is I, Tanya. Margot Robbie is a national treasure.
She's Australian.
No! No! Guys, you heard it here live. Well, she's an Australian national treasure. And this movie just, wow. It brings the story to life. It makes it compelling. Oh my gosh. I really can't say enough good things about I, Tanya. It's, you know, just you can relate to the feeling of coming from the wrong side of the tracks and... just all the garbage that she had to wade through, and then, you know, just the way that people have such a one-dimensional view of what happened. I think, you know, a lot of people just think that she's straight up guilty of whatever crime was committed against the other skater. What's her face?
Nancy
Kerrigan?
Mm-hmm.
My favorite line in the whole film, I mean... So Tanya Harding apparently had, you know, a quite abusive husband. And coming from the backwoods, she says, you know, Nancy Kerrigan gets hit once and the whole world freaks out. She's like, I get thrown around every day. I mean, I know it's not the world's great, but I just, the sardonic wit that is put into this movie and the fact that it's like, they take it, they almost put it together like it's a mock documentary. You know, you get to see the characters kind of interviewing with the camera, telling their story, and their versions of events don't always mix, and it's just so, that's such a living thing that way, you know? It's just kind of how life, everybody has a different version of the story to tell, and it's three-dimensional, you know? I love it. It's got the wildest characters, you know? It's got Sebastian Stan with a terrible mustache, Mussy, and Allison Janney puts in just a fantastic performance with her favorite co-star, the
bird,
the macaw. No, right. Not a macaw. That one's a real parrot. The macaw is the big guy. Anyway. Yeah,
parakeet.
No. The macaw is actually the big parrot you usually picture.
No, I know what a macaw is, but...
Hers was a parakeet? I thought it was like a small parrot.
Maybe, I don't know.
Maybe it was a cockatiel or parakeet or something. Oh, it was a parakeet. You're totally right. Her dress had something that looked a lot more like a parrot on it at the Oscars. I'll just say that. Yep. All right, that's my memory of that.
All right, my number three, also spoiled by Jessica. This one is The Florida Project. My number one, two, and three all were kind of in, well, even Detroit were at one point, you know, all in contention for my favorite film of the year, just by how, you know, they shook me and how they stuck with me. I ultimately went a different way because, you know, The Florida Project is another one that it is available on Amazon Prime, but it is also hard to watch, you know, because you see suffering. But you also see joy and you see, you know, children being children, and it's fantastic. And Willem Dafoe is great.
The child actors are amazing.
You know, Willem Dafoe doesn't get, he does get roles like this. You know, I think, you know, one instance would be like in Platoon, you know, he was very sympathetic in that.
Oh, that's true.
And he's done these types of roles before, and they're great, you know, and people always think of him as a strange face, but, you know, he fits in this world perfectly. You know, he's very naturalistic, and he works great in this movie, and the non-professional actors, like the young girl in it, are fantastic as well. So, yeah, The Florida Project is my number three. Just a beautiful, beautiful film, so.
All right, and my number three is a movie called Band-Aid. And I just love it, guys. It's about young people who are married, and it's about people me and Steven's age who are married. You know what I mean? It's not about your typical, what you think of as a married couple. It's kind of married millennials in a way. And just like the honesty about relationships, it's about a couple whose marriage is struggling, and so they decide to start a band to work out their frustrations and as a form of therapy.
Yeah, they turn all their fights into songs. So.
And let's not forget the pizza harmonica thing. You gotta watch it. And their strange neighbor that they bring into it. It's just a great movie, just about the, you know, honest struggles of making a relationship work, but how it's, you know, worth it.
Fun fact, all the crew were women.
Hey! Directed by the female lead.
And she, yeah, and
her name is
Zoe Lister-Jones. And it also co-stars Adam Pally from Happy Endings and The Mindy Project and Fred Armisen, so.
Who is the strange neighbor. Guys, it's fantastic.
Okay. All right, well, I'm on to my number two, also spoiled by Jessica. This one is Colossal. This is one that I saw in the theater, and then I immediately had to get Jessica to see it, because it's a powerful movie, and I know it's a year later, but I kind of don't want to kind of spoil where it goes, because it does go in an interesting perspective and tells a different story than you think it's going to tell. You know, you may think of it as an addiction story, which it is, but it's also a story of finding yourself and, you know, feminism and standing up against, you know, toxic masculinity. And it's a fantastic film that uses kaiju as as a fantastic metaphor. And it is streaming on Hulu if you have it. So check out Colossal.
Yes. All right. Colossal and bleepin' Anne Hathaway. So my number two is Coco. And I realize it's a Pixar movie, but they kind of come out at a pace that's hard to keep up with. And I know a lot of people who haven't seen it yet, and that's a shame. Because this movie made me ugly cry in the theaters. A lot like Lion last year. Just a beautiful story of family and what it means, the connections that we have to each other, to our past, to our future, our present. Oh, it's just beautiful, guys. You just need to see it and cry like me at the end, which is beautiful. remember Coco.
Aw, I'm glad you liked Coco.
It was beautiful.
So we're at our number ones. And we both have a number one that the other person doesn't have.
Oh, hey, Coco is the movie that gave me joy. Sorry, afterthought. Go ahead.
But it also made you cry, ugly cry.
Happy tears.
number one film. this has always been like sitting in the back, and you know, it took me a while to think hard about which one was going to be in my number one, and I'm not disappointed that it's this one, because this is a movie that definitely not many people got to see. I think it was a huge big flop at the box office and stuff like that, but it is currently available to stream on Amazon Prime, and this is the James Gray film, The Lost City of Z, or as they would say in the film, The Lost City of Zed, because they're British. And James Gray, you know, a few years ago in like 2013, he made a film called The Immigrant, which cracked my top 10 list, because it's just a beautifully, you know, made melodrama. It's got Marion Cotillard and Joaquin Phoenix and Jeremy Renner. He makes movies they don't really make anymore. He makes like these gorgeously lush films. They feel like David Lean films. And we're going to talk more about David Lean here in a bit, because we got a few movies that we're gonna, of his that we're going to talk to, like Lawrence of Arabia and Bridge on the River Kwai. But, and I feel sad that this one didn't make very much, because I really want to see James Gray make films like this. You know, it tells the story of this, you know, explorer going through the Amazon trying to find what he, you know, at first he's on another expedition, but then he finds artifacts that he thinks might indicate that there used to be an older civilization out there. So, you know, and it's about his repeated trips to make that discovery. And Robert Pattinson is good, Sienna Miller is good, Tom Holland is good, you know, or Spider-Man. Angus McFadden, I think, is my favorite side character, as a guy who joins the adventure and then they wish he had not joined.
He really reminds me of Dr. Octopus.
Alfred Molina.
He reminds me of a kind of a young Alfred Molina / David Crummelt's kind of big burly guy.
Interesting combo there, but yeah,
it's like they had a love child, guys.
My number one film is The Lost City of Zed. Look it up on Amazon Prime, please.
And my last film is probably one of the movies that has actually impacted me the most this last year.
I was surprised to see this was your number one film.
It's definitely not an easy movie to watch, because it is a sad, sad story. It's Mudbound, which is based on a novel, and it's kind of Depression era, World War II era South, and I can't remember which state it's in necessarily, or if it's just kind of generally. I'm sure it's based in a state, but it's about a farm where which is being sharecropped.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, the sharecroppers, the black family who are working the land, and the white family who come in owning the land and end up having to live on the farm with the black folks, which is kind of an unusual circumstance. But just the way that it tells the story of the power dynamics in the South after the Civil War, you know, some generations that still existed. And I mean, it's something you kind of know in the back of your head, but this just puts it right out there. And it doesn't hold back any punches. You really see the way these people feel about their second-class citizenship, and the way that they're still very much under the thumb of white people who feel superior, act superior, make them inferior. I mean, one of the main characters is the son of the family of sharecroppers who's coming back from the war, and he's a war hero. He fought in the Red Tail? No.
Tuskegee Airmen.
With the Tuskegee Airmen. He was a pilot. He was heroic. And he comes back to his
hometown. No, he wasn't. He was a tank lieutenant.
Are you sure he was a tank
lieutenant? Yeah.
He was. You're right. The other guy is telling the story of some of the Tuskegee Airmen who saved his life. But just to see a war hero treated the way he is treated because of the color of his skin, it's something I never, ever thought about. And is part of these people's lives and history and the way their families have been treated. And it's impacted me, guys. Detroit is visceral, but this movie gets to the moral heart of this issue in a way that I'd never seen. And is it the filmographer or the director who's African American.
The director is African American.
And she's a woman, and she's incredible. And yes. The film is so beautiful and so good.
The cinematographer is a woman as well. Yeah. And she was the first woman to ever be nominated for an Oscar for cinematography. And she shot Black Panther. So
she's awesome. Okay. Basically. It's just, so it's streaming on Netflix, and I didn't see it coming, and we just watched it randomly one Sunday, and I haven't been able to get it out of my head. And it's amazing.
Fantastic. Well, you know, that's almost a full episode, but we're not even half done, guys. So
we'll pick up the pace.
First, we're going to talk about Sunrise, I guess.
Yes.
So, Jessica, I had you research this thing. I decided I'm not going to look up anything about this film. So why don't you educate us about this movie? So this is a silent film, a melodrama, if you will. I'll just give a brief breakdown of what the plot is. We actually watched it on YouTube. It's probably in the public domain, so you guys can probably find it on there if you want. But it tells the tale of this farmer and his wife. And the farmer is philandering around with his lady from out of town, who's not so subtly suggests that he drown his wife.
And run off with her.
And sell his farm and run with her to the city. And so...
they even have a baby. What would happen to the baby? I don't even know.
The baby would have a new stepmother, you know? I'm sure she'd be a nice stepmother to the farmer. Sure. Or he can live with his grandma. I think he had a grandma. But yeah, so the farmer, you know, takes his wife out on the water, but can't really bring himself to drown her. And then they get to the town where they were traveling, and she runs away from him, and they have a rather interesting, you know, trip. You know, they stop by a church and see a wedding, and they fall back in love, essentially. And then they travel back and they get caught in a storm, and then it appears that the wife has drowned for real this time. But then it turns out, no, she's okay. So that's the movie in a nutshell.
That's the movie in a nutshell. Ignore glazing over a lot of the problematic actions of the husbands. Mm-hmm. But we'll, you know, you can form your own opinions on that. It's quite blatant if you watch it. But I mean, the movie really still pulls it off, you know? I love silent film. This movie is from 1927. It was directed by a German director who was part of the Expressionist movement. And, you know, in the times kind of pre-golden era Hollywood, Germany was almost the cinema capital. It almost beat out Hollywood as the place to be for films. And when you watch expressionist silent films, you know why. Because there's just such, there's just so much, they're pieces of art, you know?
Mm-hmm.
The sets, it's not just life, it's life on steroids.
Yeah, I feel like this is where film really started to take off as a medium. Like, the editing is rather creative. You know, there's a scene where the woman who is trying to seduce the farmer is, like, doing a little dance, kind of explaining how great city life is. And then, like, it cuts in the background. You see a bunch of city life and stuff like that. Oh, yeah. And then on the flip side, you know, there's a scene where the husband and wife, having reconciled, are walking through the city, and then all of a sudden the city disappears around them, and they're in their quiet, serene farm life. But then, like, a bunch of cars, you know, stop and start honking at them in the middle of the road and stuff like that, and it jostles them out of it. You know, it's these kind of things that really developed the language of film as we know it today. Definitely. You know?
Well, and, you know, I've never noticed, do they call it tracking when the screen follows a character instead of being a static?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Because I haven't seen that in a lot of silent films. You can see why this is such a landmark silent film, because the director really does have that art. He has that style. He does dream sequences. He does interesting photo-on-photo editing. And he even does tracking, where the camera will follow the character and kind of be a little more intimate than just a big blank screen where they're, you know, it's like instead of like a stage, like a mm-hmm. static. So, I mean, you can see a lot of the craftsmanship in this movie that Expressionism kind of developed. And this was his first film that he made in America. It's F.W. Murnau.
Mm-hmm.
And
You might know him as the director of Nosferatu.
Yes. He's an interesting guy. He had a film studio in Germany with Conrad Veidt, who was a, you know, part of some pretty famous expressionist films. The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, which, side note, if we were doing recommendations in this episode, that's what I would recommend. The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari is amazing, and it's kind of a Tim Burton-esque, just really interesting film. Mm-hmm. And Conrad Veidt's really cool. He was in a movie called The Man Who Laughs, which became the inspiration for the character of the Joker. So the artistic nature of these movies is really amazing. Like, one of the coolest things I've ever heard was... it's a radio play based on the Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. So it takes a purely visual medium and turns it into a purely audio medium, and it's just the coolest. And it's amazing how expressionism lends enough to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, Murnau is definitely a master of that. And he was talked by William Fox into coming to America, joining Fox Studios, and making this film. It was the first one with soundtracking. Mm-hmm. Which means they created a soundtrack with music and sound effects together that would go out with the film instead of...
Yeah, like you can hear some cases, like they never have it sync up with the actors, but you can hear people yelling in the background and stuff like that,
mm-hmm.
and cars honking and things like that. So it's almost like a sound film, but not quite.
Yeah, yeah. It wasn't, you know, just a score sent out to people to improvise at the theater. It was kind of mm-hmm. a set. You know, the girl who played the farmer's wife... she won an Academy Award for this film as Best Actress. This film won basically what would become the Best Picture film.
I'll have to check my Oscar thing. This might have been like the first Oscars or something
during
like that.
The first Oscars in 1929, this film and two other films got the lead lady an Oscar. Wasn't it? What is it? Margaret something? No, that might have been the City Woman.
Janet Gaynor, I want to say, or something like that.
Sorry, guys, I'm not as fluent on these old actresses, and I don't have my notes in front of me, but, you know, it got some recognition, but it's just amazing. It's so watchable for being a silent film.
It
is. A lot of people find silent film boring, but this is pretty compelling. And how can you find silent movies boring, guys? It's a look into the past. It's amazing.
It is amazing, guys. Check out some silent films. And in the future, we're going to have a few more to go over. So stay tuned.
Yeah. So that was Sunrise, 1927.
Speaking of movies that start with S, we also saw Spartacus.
I'm Spartacus. We'll go over that again. Just kidding.
Jessica, I'm Spartacus.
Go ahead.
So yeah, this was... made apparently because Kirk Douglas was jealous that he didn't get cast in Ben-Hur.
Yep. That's how this movie started, guys.
And this is a very significant movie. You know, it's directed by Stanley Kubrick, but loosely termed directed. You know, he didn't really, it's not really his cup of tea. Or the type of movie you'd really associate with Stanley Kubrick.
Yeah, it was made in 1960, which is kind of the end of the studio era of Hollywood. Mm-hmm. But there was definitely still some studio influence in this movie.
Yeah, like the initial director was Anthony Mann, who directed the first scene and then got fired. But, you know, that kind of set the tone for the rest of the film. But the basics of this tone is it follows this man who's been a slave his whole life, Spartacus. And he's taken to a gladiator school where he's trained on being a gladiator. And then, like, at the gladiator school, some wealthy Romans come and they have some of the gladiators fight to the death. And one of the gladiators, the one who's fighting Spartacus, you know, has him pinned down, and then he refuses to kill Spartacus and instead tries to kill the Romans who is enslaving them. But is killed in the process. And, you know, that sacrifice really kickstarts this slave rebellion in which, you know, all these different slaves from different countries are starting to uprise against Rome.
And they're definitely way on the outskirts. There's some province in the middle of nowhere. And then this, you know, the news of their deeds gets back to Rome and the Senate. And, you know, we get some highfalutin Romans and senators trying to...
Yes. And then...
interfere with these slaves and not let them leave the country. And
yeah, you know, and what did you think of this movie, Jessica? Was this your first time seeing it?
I want to say it was, but I definitely remember the bit of, I'm Spartacus. But I think it was my first time. But I've seen some Peter Ustinov films.
Yeah.
Where he plays Spartacus. And so I may have seen this one, but this time I can definitely tell you it's more watchable than Ben-Hur. Kirk Douglas did a good job.
Yeah, you know, and another thing behind this story is, the screenplay was written by then blacklisted screenwriter Dalton Trumbo. And this was one of the first movies where...
one of the blacklisted authors was given credit publicly for their work again.
Mm-hmm. And thus, you know, helping to end that blacklist. And there is some key, you know, things that really resonate in this...
You know, the blacklisted screenwriters and Hollywood folks, it was with regard to the McCarthy era, you know, the congressional hearings, and they were basically ousted for being socialists. But this movie really is kind of not straight out and out socialist, but definitely the proletariat, the oppressed, rise up, find your worth.
Well,
it had elements.
Elements of that, you know. I think the most pointed... reference to McCarthyism is after you know Laurence Olivier plays the ruler of the legions of Rome who resigns, basically trying to ploy them to beg him to save them from this slave rebellion.
Mm-hmm.
And then after he makes it so that the slaves can't escape and they have to march on Rome, the people then re-elect him and give him basically complete power.
Yeah. And the senator that was trying to foil him the whole time gets...
put on a list.
Put on a list. A list!
Charles Laughton. Charles Laughton is so enjoyable in this film.
He's great. He and Peter Ustinov are just like... mm-hmm. These great bosom buddies.
They're great schemers, you know. he's kind of like a character who revels in his own... corruptedness, but you know, he has a point. He was like, I'll take a little bit of Republican corruption with some Republican freedom and stuff like that. And you know, Laurence Olivier is always referring to them as the mob.
Would you
and
say
stuff like that.
Corruption or glutton?
Well, he used the word corruption.
He does.
In
he
the
does. they definitely overindulge in the fine things of life. So I guess that is mm-hmm. kind of corruption when you're taking.
But yeah, anyway. He's also quite fat.
They're fat friends, guys. I love Peter Ustinov, so mm-hmm. I like his friend in this. He does do a good job. What's his name, the actor, again?
Which one?
The senator.
Charles Laughton.
Rhymes with glutton. Just kidding. Sorry, guys. Sorry, Charles.
And then you've also got, you know, Kirk Douglas and Gene Simmons, who was really beautiful in this film.
She was striking. The slave rebellion almost kind of actually happened because they took away Gene Simmons,
yeah.
Kirk Douglas's lady friend,
yeah.
who he liked to make eyes at as a gladiator.
Yeah, he was like, what? You took my lady friend?
That's it. Freedom!
Freedom!
Oh, this movie, guys.
I don't feel we're doing this movie justice, but
we are
kind of spacey and running low on time.
Definitely. Spartacus, it's funny, Kirk Douglas found it because there was a book written about it, and it's kind of, I'm trying to think of, it's based off an old myth, so it's about this old Roman character named Spartacus, in the same way that I had thought of a movie to compare it to. But, you know, Spartacus is an interesting take on an old story, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a few years ago, they did, like, some Starz miniseries about Spartacus, which had a lot more violence and boobs in it, so. It also has Lucy Lawless and Xena.
Oh,
and
Zeno.
John Hannah plays the... he's actually the Peter Ustinov role in it. But
go.
It's quite different in that one.
Give me Ustinov any day. So yeah, this one is definitely a piece of old Hollywood worth seeing. It's got the scale of an old Hollywood film.
Yeah, the battle scenes were actually really well done, you know. It's like, man, this is a battle scene. This is like almost on scale with like Lord of the Rings, or some cases more legible.
Yeah, I heard Kubrick was totally OCD about this. He had scripted out, you know, there's a scene of the battlefield after the battle littered with people. Those extras had numbers and very specific instructions about how they were to be the dead bodies. So Kubrick really planned this one to the last detail, and it was filmed on location in Spain.
Okay, that does sound so like
the rest Kubrick. Of it's kind of studio, but the battle scenes are in Spain.
I just bought this Kubrick documentary. We need to watch it sometime. So
for sure.
But it's too late tonight. This is one of those stuff that dreams are nights.
Stuff that dreams are nights. If you're listening to this as you're going to bed,
yeah. We are yawning. Is it time for bed, Jessica?
Almost. We just got one last thing to say to you guys, and that is about our fun summer contest, and we'll just wrap it up with that.
Okay. So I was going to do this on the other show, Steven and Steven and Steven, but we had a little bit of scheduling issues, so we'll have that episode come out. But I wanted to get this rolling before the summer, just for fun, funsies. So me and Jessica started doing it. And first it was just going to be something between us, but we thought we might let you guys in on it in case you wanted to play around next summer. It's a little late to start it this summer.
Yeah.
Unless you do it for the remaining summer. So basically, this is stolen from the Movie BS podcast. So what they do is they, you know, at the start of the summer, you know, right before May, that's when we did it.
Mm-hmm.
We basically draft films that we think are going to have the highest opening box office weekends.
Of the summer.
And then, so we each selected 10 films.
Ranging from, was it June to?
May to August,
you're right.
Mm-hmm. All the summer season films. And what's going to happen is at the end of the summer, and we'll keep you guys posted on our Facebook page and sporadically as we record these podcasts over the summer. Of where we're at.
We take our opposing lists and chalk up how much they earn and see whose films gross the most.
Gross the most over the opening weekend.
Oh, on opening weekend, yes.
Just so we can wrap this up a lot sooner. So.
It's March Madness, but better. Okay, and there's no, what do you call it?
Bracket?
Bracketing.
Yeah, it's more like the draft.
Yeah.
It's not March Madness, Jessica.
But it is! March Madness sounds like more fun.
Alright, so I don't have the original list in which we drafted things, but on my little Google Doc here, we do have what has come out already. We have set them up in chronological order, just so we can more easily keep track of how much each movie makes. So, let's go over Jessica's list, or we'll go over my list first. So the earliest movie I had was Life of the Party with Melissa McCarthy. That was one of my later drafts. I mean, I thought it might do well. And it did $17,886,075. So for 1 week, I was winning. But Jessica had claimed Deadpool 2. So right now, she's beating me by over $105 million. Sure, because Deadpool 2 made $125,507,153.
I mean,
$125,507,153.
Yes.
Does that check out?
That checks out.
All right. So I'm gonna go over the rest of the films that I have on my list here. So this coming up weekend, I've got a Solo, a Star Wars Story. And then on June 22nd, I've got Jurassic World. And then on June 29th, I've got Uncle Drew. I've just been seeing the trailers for that over and over, and I thought, you know, might as well. On July 13th, I've got Hotel Transylvania 3 and The Rock Skyscraper. Mm. On July 20th, I've got The Equalizer 2. On July 27th, I've got Mission Impossible Fallout. On August 10th, I've got The Meg, Jason Statham meets a giant shark.
And then on August 17th, I've got the rom-com Crazy Rich Asians.
He stole it out from under me, guys.
I picked it like ninth, Jessica. I know, I know.
And then as for the rest of my list, I had Deadpool 2. And then on June 8th, I will have Ocean's 8. And I will also have a little film called Hotel Artemis. I haven't seen any trailers for this, which bodes ill. But
I've seen trailers for it.
Oh, yes.
Looks good.
It's got a lot of great actors and actresses. So Hotel Artemis, June 15th, Incredibles 2, July 6th, Ant-Man and the Wasp, July 20th, Mamma Mia 2, July 27th, Teen Titans Go to the movies, August 3rd, The Spy Who Dumped Me, August 17th, The Happy Time Murders, and August 24th, Slender Man, because those kids are everywhere.
Mm-hmm. So. There's a clickable article, and it's like, I invaded Iraq to impress the Slender Man by George W. Bush.
All right.
So, yeah, we've got some independent stakes going on in here. So, for instance, whoever is going to... We've been very terrible at maintaining our social media presence. So whoever loses this thing has to post weekly on there for 6 months.
For the rest of the year. Mm-hmm. Bi-weekly for the rest of the year.
Yes.
And I think that that person should get to pick the prize that we give to listeners at the end of the summer.
Okay.
We're going to... they're going to pick a giveaway. So they're going to get a punishment, but also a little silver lining. They get to pick something nice to hand out.
Yes. See, when it was going to be me and Steve C, the loser would have to give the prize, but since we live in a shared income household, that doesn't seem like much of a wager. It seems like lose-lose for us. So, but yeah, we still want to give you guys something for checking in on us and watching these movies with us. Jessica, what movies are we going to watch next month?
Oh, well, next month it looks like we are coming up with The Apartment, the 1960 movie. And then
Billy Wilder.
With Billy Wilder.
They're directed by Billy Wilder. Oh, it's got Jack Lemmon and Shirley MacLaine.
Oh, I have not heard of this one, so that will be interesting. And the 1936 film, the 1969 film, The Wild Bunch.
That's one I have not seen, but I found it in like a dollar bin stack, so... We're going to watch it.
All right. Next month. You guys have a good month until we talk again.
Yeah, we'll see you after I'm beating Jessica. I've climbed ahead of Deadpool with Han Solo at my back.
You know what that sounds like?
What?
The stuff that dreams are made of.
I bet it is. Anyways, I'm Steven Sparky Parker.
And I'm Jessica Parker.
And I'm Spartacus! 2 minutes too late. And isn't it I?